Hey folks, Kilt-Man here. Kilt-Man at your services. How are you all? I hope you're all doing very, very well. Now, a couple of points of housekeeping first. I'm wearing the Hunting McCloud today. Oh, hey, the Hunting McCloud. A fabulous tartan, a fabulous kilt. Oh, he loves it, oh, he does. And secondly, autumn hit yesterday with a one of them. Literally, overnight, it's turned into furious storms, ferocious downpours, cataclysmic thunder and lightning. Yes, we've had it all. But as you can see right now, the sun is out. But it won't last, folks. The sun will disappear again and the clouds will scuttle back and the wind will rise and the rain will lash down and it'll go very, very preternaturally dark in this room. So just letting you know. Anyway, folks, we lost another one. Another great legend of the big screen, the small screen, and the stage as well. James Earl Jones, yes. The profundo basso voice. Some would say baritone, but people are up and down on this. We lost him on Monday. We lost him on the 9th of September 2024, aged 93. See, it's gone darker already. And the news broke yesterday, worldwide, and here's a tribute to him because he looms large forever in our imagination, our estimation, because he was one of the world's greatest screen talents. It wasn't just the voice that carried him. Lucas, wow, the voice. I don't want you in a Darth Vader costume. No, we want a bodybuilder for that. Although James Earl Jones was 6'2", which to me, that's statuesque to a hobbit like me. But no, they got Dave Prowse, who we lost a couple of years ago. We did a tribute to him as well. And so now we have lost. The Sith Lord has gone. No, they last forever, these stars. These legends, they only shine brighter now. But yeah, age 93. I'm not sure what he actually died of in the end, but old age. And I'll be honest, I do a lot of these tributes to celebrities, actors, filmmakers, and or musicians, and it sometimes gets to me and really affects me, and I get quite emotional about it. But I love James Earl Jones, always have done, since Darth Vader and Conan the Barbarian, and then seeing him in many, many other things, of course. But at 93, I'm like, you led such a full, rich, and colourful life that no, you did everything that you set out to do, and you became a huge figurehead for African-American actors and African-Americans all round, and for everybody. But he's a lot more than Darth Vader. So I don't think I'm going to get emotional about this one, because you've lived, my friend, you've lived, and you've enriched all of our lives as well. So he was born 17th of January 1931 in a place called Arkabutler, I probably mispronounced that, Mississippi. And he was, from very early age, had a profound stutter, a really nasty stutter. I know it's hard to imagine that voice stuttering.
No. Search your feelings. You know it to be. No, wait, I'll get this. True. I am your father.
I'm not making light of people who stutter. I'm not. It's just hard to imagine that voice stuttering and that commanding presence, being so frightened, intimidated and shy about that condition that he went mute for years. Mute. And what happened as well in the meantime, he became disenfranchised from his mother and father and went to live with his grandparents. And that didn't work out so well either, apparently. It wasn't the best of upbringings. But in school, he had a teacher that went, look, an English teacher, and said, like, look, I've got an idea that can maybe get you out of this fugue. Poetry. So he began to write poetry, James Earl Jones, and the teacher encouraged him to read it aloud to the class. and it broke through that wall of his horror and self-outrage at his stuttering voice and got him round it. Iambic pentameter works in a great deal of cases, and got him into drama, acting. Acting seems to be a great cathartic release for people who have crippling social conditions like shyness or, you know, insecurity. You act, you become someone else, you put a mask on, you become someone else. Just to break off, to shine a light on this, Sean Bean, the great Sean Bean, yeah, Boromir, is absolutely shy and awkward as hell in interviews. Terrible, terrible. You think he stutters and he mumbles and he loses track. Within a couple of words, he's lost and he just sits there. And yet he can be fantastic, well, is fantastic on screen. So the proof is there, and with James Earl Jones, acting brings out the talent that is there, which would be otherwise camouflaged by a crippling social condition. So he learns to enunciate his words and to use that voice of his and gain confidence and to act. So he loses the stutter, but he starts acting. Anyway, but before we get to the acting, oh, he did drama in school and college. He did all this and he was great and all that. And that was his driving thing. But he also enrolled in military cadets and then went into the army, the US Army. And the war in Korea was rife at this time. And he wanted action. He wanted service in Korea. He was part of a military company of actors as well. So even in the military, he was still acting and using that voice, that commanding voice. And he goes to Ranger School. Yeah, the Rangers. Yeah, James Earl Jones got his Ranger tab. Now, he didn't join the Ranger Battalion. He did not do that. He went to a headquarters battalion. And to my knowledge, he didn't, although he wanted to, he didn't get out to Korea to fight. That didn't happen. And he graduated from officer training school with a commission to second lieutenant. And then he was told, ordered, like, you and your battalion, you're going to go and create a Cold Warfare training school. Go do it. So he did. And then they became the training wing for the army. See, Rangers, you go and get that tab, but don't join the Rangers. You're qualified to lead other soldiers, to train other soldiers. And that's what he did. So by the end of the Korean War, which I don't think he actually went out there. Someone could correct me on this, but I don't think he did. He was commissioned as a first lieutenant. And then he left the army and pursued drama and acting with a vengeance. And my God, this is a guy that, well, we'll talk to his movies, but acting wise on stage, he was part, he's done Broadway. He's won every bloody award going. He's what they call an EGOT. An EGOT, that means he got the Emmy, the Grammy, the Oscar, and a Tony. He's an EGOT, and there aren't many of those around. Now, he did Broadway, he did Shakespeare in the Park productions of Othello, of King Lear, of Coriolanus, of, what else did he do? Hamlet as well, made a name for himself. He then did many other stage productions, and most famously, well, Fences. Fences is a great, great movie with Denzel Washington, but Fences is based on an original stage production. It's set in the 50s, African-American family, and the father, the patriarch. He has high hopes, aspirations, but things don't always work out for him. And he turns on his family in various different ways. And James Earl Jones played that father figure. And Denzel Washington actually, to make the movie Fences, the movie adaptation, went to James Earl Jones and, like, you know, look, I need your advice. I want to play your role. And the two sat and spoke, and Denzel gave a wonderful performance as well. I'd love to have seen the stage production of Fences. That toured around America. He did it on Broadway, and then The same cast went around the provinces as well. And then it changed, the cast changed and all that. Well, obviously James Earl Jones went on to bigger things, you know, in a long, long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. Yeah. Well, he didn't go there. He just supplied the voice there, Darth Vader. But acting in big movies, he got his breakthrough. His debut was Stanley Kubrick's Doctor Strangelove. It's only a small, smallish role, but he's there, has a presence. And then the big screen loved him. And the great thing about James Earl Jones is it's not that voice, that immediately recognisable, the voice of CNN. I don't know.
This is CNN. You know,
the thing is, people always do that. Talk about James Earl Jones. You immediately do that and start talking about, you know,
you don't know the power of the dark side.
But he did so much more. And but the voice isn't just the thing that he's got, his commanding gravitas. It's his power as an actor. This is a guy that could play a mentor, a villain. He could play a romantic lead. He could play Shakespearean actors. He was in biblical stuff. He was in Jesus of Nazareth as well. He played Pharaoh in Moses as well, in another TV version. But he could play anything. He could apply himself. Roots. You know, the African-American. The pioneering spirit and slavery. And how he brought all of that to the forefront of American and worldwide psyche and imagination. When it was just being brushed under the carpet for such a long, long time. A scab on society's arse. But he brought that out, a great character, very commanding performance. So what I'm saying is, the voice, you think, oh, that voice, we need that voice. That voice is so powerful, they can control the cosmos. But the guy could act as well. He could do all these things, play any kind of character. Admiral Greer in the Jack Ryan movies, Hunt for Red October, Patriot Games, Clear and Present Danger, and he was a recurring figure in those. But also, he's Mufasa, the Lion King, Simba's daddy. Unbelievable. And again, the power, the sacrifice. It isn't just the voice. There's something about Mufasa that even in the animation, you can see James Earl Jones. They're vastly different colours, but they're modelling it on his vocal performance as well. The way that he commands a stage, a screen, that regal, noble quality. Darth Vader, Thulsa Doom. Thulsa Doom there. In John Milius's fabulous 1982 Conan the Barbarian. Now, after Darth Vader and Star Wars, it was this that brought him to my attention. And a terrifying character, totally in control of his own cult, of his own superstardom. But he's got words of wisdom. You know, he converts the riddle of steel. You killed my mother. You killed my father. You took my father's sword. The riddle of steel. You know the riddle of steel? I can't do the voice at all. And nor should I even attempt to, really. But it's like, oh, it's gone dark. It's like James himself was saying, don't you attempt to do my voice. You can't do it. Just sit there and drink your whiskey, of which there is not a great deal left. Cheers, y'all. Cheers, James. Rest in peace. He subverts the riddle of steel. He's like, poor Conan's been beaten up there. And Thulsa Doom's like, you know, on the cliff edges, there's all beautiful women lined up there. He's like, flesh is strong, boy. Yeah, there. See that beautiful girl? And she leaps off and shatters herself through the air, the scaffolding, the wooden scaffolding. He says, that is strength, boy. That is power. What is steel compared to the hand that wields it, you know. And of course, then again, contemplate this boy on the tree of woe. Fantastic performance. A frightening character, but as I say, this dimensionality to Thulsa Doom, especially at the end, you know, where Conan's killed all his warriors, the Battle of the Mounds, and then comes back to the temple of the snake cult. And there's Thulsa Doom about to give his speech to all his children. And he turns around and there's Conan there. It's very similar to the end of Apocalypse Now, which John Milius had a hand in now as well. And he's there like, "My child, you have come to me in your time of need. My son, for you are my son, for what am I if not your father?" And poor old Thulsa Doom gets decapitated and his head does that floppity flop down the stone steps. But a magnificent character again. But he wouldn't stop. He did theatre, he did TV, he kept on doing movies. More movies. Think of the Dreams. Magnificent. Again, a ghostly mentor. You know. So I don't understand baseball, but the film had a profound effect upon me because of its dreamlike. Look, you can bring back the past, your dreams can come true. You can settle people's age-old arguments, and you can still live a full life yourself. Its message is brilliant. And then he's King Joffrey in Coming to America. He's great in that as well. He could send himself up. He could play. Oh, look, James, you know, not being stereotypical here, but could you play a big African king? You know, of course I can. You know, of course he could. He could play anything. He could be anything he wanted to be. What else did he do? Grim Prairie Tales. People don't look at that. The opening narration to Sly Stallone's Judge Dredd as well. Matawan, fantastic. Mention Roots, Jesus of Nazareth, Picket Fences, which isn't like a sequel to the stage play and the film Fences. It was its own TV thing. But he had two great cameos as well in two of my favourite American comedy shows. He was in Frasier, and it was brilliant, but it was poignant as well. Frasier, we won't go into the whole thing, but Frasier ends up inadvertently in an old age care home, and he blunders into someone's room, and it's James Earl Jones, you know, an old guy now in a care home who's blind, and they sit and have a great conversation, and it's funny, but it's poignant as well. And James Earl Jones absolutely seals it. Now, he's got a face cast of his deceased wife when she was younger. And he says, like, "No, I can't see her anymore, but I feel her face, her cheeks, her nose, wonderful bone structure," and all this. Like, because Frasier, being Frasier, manages to drop this thing and break the nose off it, and then spend half the episode trying to, like, find the nose, which James Earl Jones sits on. And then when he's... What time is it now? Oh, his alarm goes off. He goes, "What? Oh, I must take my tablets now. You know, at my age, I take a lot of tablets." And off he goes. And Frasier's trying to stick this nose back on. It's just not working. But it transpires that in the end, Frasier leaves, but his conscience gets better of him. He comes back. So, "No, I wasn't looking for a cufflink," or whatever his bogus story was. "I was looking for your wife's nose because I broke it off." And he goes, "Oh, that happens all the time. I break it every day." Just stick it back on. But it's a lovely moment. And it is James Earl Jones doing what he does best. You know, not a nasty Thulsa Doom, but he offers sage-like words of wisdom. His warmth, his compassion shines through. I said I wasn't going to get emotional, but saying that now and hearing that. It's a lovely, touching thing. I love it in comedy shows. I've said this many times. Comedy shows and comedy movies, when comedians and comics turn serious, because if they're good at it, and the good ones are great, Robin Williams could do this, Richard Pryor could do this, Jim Carrey can definitely do it, Steve Martin can do it, Kelsey Grammer can do it as well. A lot of them, when it suddenly turns just a little bit serious, and oh, you've got to sort of swap, oh, we're not meant to laugh now, oh God, and suddenly, well, that episode had it, and it was wonderful, and it was James Earl Jones that did it. He was also in The Big Bang Theory, and he meets Sheldon, or rather Sheldon meets him, and, you know, he's there with the menu, he looks up there, this is James Earl Jones, and there's Sheldon there, like that. If you don't know The Big Bang Theory, I'm sure you do, Sheldon has got a lot of issues, but he's a scientist and a complete and utter nerd, alongside all his mates as well. They're all scientists, boffins that love Star Trek and Star Wars. And like James Earl Jones is sitting there going like, you know me from Star Wars, don't you? You like Star Wars, don't you? You know, I've made many more movies than just Star Wars. Sheldon's just like, but you don't care about those, do you? You only care about Star Wars. And they form a relationship, and they travel around the entire day and into the night. I think they play poker, they go to a strip club as well, and James Earl Jones is giving, you know, when I met Alec Guinness and all this, and like George Lucas was blah, blah, blah. And Sheldon's initially like wowed by all of this. They even go and prank Carrie Fisher. Yes, the Carrie Fisher, who's sadly deceased as well now. And it's great, but in the end, Sheldon's bored. he's met one of his all-time heroes. He's met Darth Vader, and he's like, he's boring. He's trying to get away. But it's brilliant because James Earl Jones sends not only Darth Vader up, but he sends himself up and people's perceptions of him. And not everyone can do that. Now, there's not a lot of poignancy in that one, but the Frasier one got that. But certainly James Earl Jones could plumb the depths of emotion and create purely three-dimensional characters. And the weird thing is, even just that voice in Star Wars, you get the gravity of who he is. And he's got a backstory, he's got a history, he has relationships. Yeah, well, Revenge of the Sith. Oh, I'll have to have a drink before I discuss this. Because he would return to voice Darth Vader in Rogue One, obviously Revenge of the Sith, and he's in Obi-Wan as well, voicing Darth Vader. And Anakin's been stitched together, you know, and he's there. All the suits have been put on him, and he's there with their little baby fists, like that.
How is Padme? Is she all right?
it's absolutely god awful what they made him go through for that. But he still gave it everything. That's the voice of Vader. And when he realizes, oh no, she's dead, it's like, no,
no, no.
I'm not skitting him, I'm skitting that scene is really bad. My mother always said to me, my mother, big Kilt Mama, was an actress off stage and screen, and she said to me, like, you know, the best actors are like James Earl Jones, who had a ferocious stutter, and that held him back, made him mute for a couple of years, you know. You have to find acting is their release. She said the best actors have got a trauma, a tragedy, something that happened in their formative years and held them back, but acting gave them the release. So, I mean, I said to her, like, well, you've been on stage and screen for many, many years and years, and well, what was your tragedy and trauma? And she went, I married your father, and pointed to me dad. I married him. Okay, point taken. And speaking of my father, Big Kilt Papa, there's a connection between him and, well, James Earl Jones, well, Darth Vader. I've said this story a few times now. When they were producing Star Wars, obviously in England, the call went out to people who had German helmets from the Second World War or German uniforms and insignia. Well, my dad was a massive military historian and collector and had a huge collection of everything from every war known to man, and had his own museum. He gave stuff to the Imperial War Museum. He actually they begged him for certain things which he dug up from battlefields, and he begged him, can we have this for an exhibit, and you're going to get your name there. And there's stuff there now with Dad's name on to this day. Well, I've not been there for many years, but I presume they're still there. And so he supplied German helmets and German uniforms and insignia, because the Imperials were going to look very Germanic. That was the point of it. And John Molloy, who designed the costumes, took delivery of all of these. And so when Star Wars came out, my dad, who did not like sci-fi movies, of course, I was only a kid at the time, like, but we went to see Star Wars a million and one times, obviously. And my dad went because he was like, oh, to see what they'd done with his, because the meant to get him back, and he didn't get him back, you know, that's the other thing. But yeah, he had many, many hundreds more, so don't worry about it too much. It's gone very dark again, hasn't it? And that's probably my dad now. Oh, I never got them back. No! And so we watched Star Wars, and my dad kind of liked it, because, oh, it's just an adventure yarn, action, and but he's seeing the whole Germanic influence of the Empire, and especially the costumes and that, and he's like nudging me and all my mates, you know, I've supplied all that stuff. And anyway, it got time for Empire Strikes Back, and my dad had kind of got off sci-fi again, and he didn't get approached for Empire Strikes Back or anything, so he obviously had enough for him already. And so we went to see Empire Strikes Back at the Odeon Liverpool, the old Odeon Liverpool, which was fucking huge. And we're there at the opening, the first showing. It's packed, of course it was packed, and Empire Strikes Back. And we were all kids, and but my dad was with us. There's about 20, maybe 25 of us. There's a couple of other adults, but my dad led us there. And your first scene of Darth Vader, my dad, God, he went, Dark Zador, like that. And we were like, Dark Zador, Darth Vader. My dad got it wrong. My dad had not paid attention to any of it. Dark Zador. I mean, it would have been embarrassing enough if he'd got the name right, but he got the name wrong in front of a spellbound audience. Oh, you know, Jesus Christ, strike him down. You know, oh. But we laugh about it now. As it would transpire, my dad in his last few years, and my dad died at 94, so he outlived James Earl Jones. But my dad kind of got into, not sci-fi, but fantasy. And we showed him the Lord of the Rings, Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings trilogy. And it blew him away. He was mesmerised. These were things, he used to like Waterloo, the Rod Steiger, Christopher Plummer Waterloo. And obviously Zulu and Zulu Dawn, which he supplied stuff for Zulu Dawn as well. And A Bridge Too Far, he supplied stuff for A Bridge Too Far. And he's in A Bridge Too Far. Although he's not, he's chopped off the frame. I'm not going down that story again. I've told that a million times. So big war movies he'd always love. But it was something about Lord of the Rings, which suddenly was big war, big battles, and great characters. And he became massively smitten with it. So, you know, little aside there, but back to Mr. Jones. And there's Vader's theme. Ordinarily, folks, I've got the soundtracks to all of these movies I've mentioned, and some of the TV shows as well, but they're landlocked on my ancient and now deceased PC. So I can't play them. I can't have a playlist, so you're stuck with Star Wars, I'm afraid. But hey, there's worse things to be stuck with. But James Earl Jones, a character actor, a stage actor, a towering presence, a wonderfully articulate and communicative person, did many interviews and was wonderfully witty, brilliantly warm, compassionate. You know, people die and you never hear a bad word about them. You never hear that someone goes like, oh God, thank God they're gone. They got what was coming to them. They deserved it in the end. And I'm glad they're gone. But the people I pay tribute to simply are not like that. They don't have any skeletons in the closet. There's no controversy surrounding James Earl Jones. He's married a couple of times. He had one child. But a wonderful man. Active in certain charities, massively promoting, you know, the theatre, the arts, movie making. You know, he did his military service, and he was every report was glowing for him. Even throughout college, high school, and the cadets, every report said he was fantastic. That's why that teacher way back took. Look, you're sitting there, and like. A lot of teachers back in those early days, would have ignored him and he would have gone nowhere. But this teacher took it upon himself. And you've got to thank this guy for getting James Earl Jones for all of us. Because it's down to that teacher that brought him out of his shell and said, look, you know, how about poetry? Write your own poetry and read it out. Can you imagine that immense hurdle that he would have gone through? And the music has gone off. Well, let's start it all again with the Imperial March. And there's a confidence booster for you, isn't it? You know, you're walking down the street and you've got that playing in your ears. Everyone around just going like, who the hell does he think he is? And you're like that. And suddenly you're breathing really badly. But you need, that's what teachers should be. They should be not just like, you know, oh, copy this down, you know, they're writing on a blackboard, chalkboard, you call it now, you know, or it's just all online now, isn't it? How are they working now? I've got no idea. But they just churn the stuff out, and it's a curriculum that the government's now enforced. Teachers can't teach anymore. They can't be mentors. They can't be an inspirational figure. They're not allowed to. They're too terrified to say what they want to say. So nowadays, people like that would just be put into little certain rooms. We're like, oh, we'll try to encourage you. But it's down a set governmental format, which people still fall through the cracks in that and don't get the proper treatment they deserve. But this teacher took it on herself to say, look, no, I know this is the worst thing you want to hear right now, but I want you to write poetry and I want you to read it out. Can you imagine that? The stomach-churning fear. The first time he did it, he must have practiced and tried to get out of it, and then finally he does it and finds that voice. Maybe that's how you get a voice like that. You've got to be silent for 2 years, be mute for 2 years, and then suddenly your voice, it just goes down to the bowels of the air, not your own bowels, and when you use it, it comes out with depth and presence and power and dignity, you know. And he found it. And with that, grew confidence. Now, to go to drama, act. Maybe some of your little poetries we could turn into plays and we can do that. Or we could just do that Shakespeare guy if you want. And he wanted, and he loved it. So, Emmys, Grammys, Oscar, he got an honorary Oscar. And Tony's, and many other awards of the lesser caliber, you know. But it shows you how much the peers, you know, loved and admired his stature, his ability, his performance. You know, I know there's far more than Darth Vader, but you can't beat this. And I don't think he'd mind that being, you know, he knew everybody remembered him for that role primarily, even though he doesn't inhabit the suit. Dave Prowse does that brilliantly as well. Someone wrote about, since James Earl Jones' sad demise, about Darth Vader and Dave Prowse and James Earl Jones. And they said, now I don't know how this would be true, but I can believe it though, that James Earl Jones was so giving that in sort of rehearsals and voiceovers, he was like watching what Dave Prowse did and used his voice to sort of be signposted and led by Dave Prowse's mannerisms and, you know, all this sort of stuff, and just his head gestures, and he'd watch what he was doing, and which I suppose you've got to do anyway. But he said then that he gave so much more to Dave Prowse. So his performance in Empire and then Return of the Jedi improved and became more refined, a lot more subtleties there, because he knew how James Earl Jones was going to do this, and the two would work together in a way. Someone out there, some complete Star Wars completist, will tell me, did they ever meet? I'm sure they did, but I don't recall it. I'd like to think that they met and they conversed and they talked about inhabiting the character in the costume and bringing breath and life to the character via the voice from James Earl Jones. But it would have been a wonderful meeting. If that probably exists in some interview or documentary somewhere on the discs that I've got. So I should really go and check that out. But someone comment below, let me know. Has it been done? Well, we're almost done here. Regular viewers know this is a sad time for Kilt-Man when the whiskey draws to an end. And there is no more. But don't worry. I will get some. I will probably go out the pub while it's still sunny. So folks, yeah, people like James Earl Jones, they die at 93. They've had a military career, a fabulous career with theatre, live theatre, on stage and outdoors. Shakespeare in the Park, he did that, and travel around like a repertory company, then gets movies, then gets TV and more movies and more TV, and then becomes just a well-known celebrity, being interviewed and the voice of CNN, you know, and that's a rich life, and he lived it the way he wanted to live it. I've not seen any reports about him being unhappy apart from his childhood, but that's what brought on the stuttering, which in turn brought on the poetry and the acting, the drama, which in turn brought on superstardom. The world doth turn in mysterious ways. And I think the lesson we should learn from this, he would have been ultra terrified of standing in front of the class and read your poetry out. Now, even if you don't stutter and suddenly, you know, the class, you write poetry. I didn't get this. I've written books. I've won an award for a book and a long time ago. But I had aspirations of being a novelist and it never transpired because I did other things. It's the way life goes. But I was encouraged by my English teacher, Mr. Robinson, to read out my stuff, because he said, I'm marking your essays, your stories, and like, so they're fantastic. I was very well read, you see, as a kid, so I was emulating the likes of Stephen King, probably, at the time, like, and then Whitney Strieber, and you know, your stuff, grammatically, it's perfect, but it's inspirational, it's intelligent, it's imaginative, it's wild, I'm excited, and it's brilliant. I want you to stand there and read it out. Now, I wasn't a shy a kid at all. I was like, oh, you want me to read this out in front of all these dickheads? So I did. And the thing about that, it boosted my confidence way too much. So I began to write even more outlandish, outrageous things. And you can see he was getting a bit, all right, look, I know you can do it, but you're pushing things here, son. You are. So he'd stop me from, he's like, Macanini, don't. Don't bother reading this one out. I mean, no, sir, I will. I want to. But I blustered into it and I'd be like, no, don't, because I'd be talking about sexy things as well. And but it's a stepping stone for a lot of people, I think. So the lesson I'm saying is that sometimes you've got to confront the very thing which is holding you back. And, you know, you can build this up out of nothing. Phobias, fears, just make you freeze in certain situations. But you've got to confront it. Don't run away from what you fear. Confront it, face it head on. You might not defeat it straight away, but it's worth having a go. James Earl Jones is exactly the personification of that. I think people are not getting this whole stuttering thing and how bad and crippling that can be. To go mute for a couple of years, which he did, to just not say a word and to suffer that, suffer in silence, literally suffering in silence, and then be confronted like, well, here's your ultimate test. At that sort of stage in your life, when you everything's frightening, I'm not saying he was bullied. He probably, by all accounts, he was very, very popular. In school, in high school, in cadets, and army training, and he loved the military. He loved that environment. He felt at home in that environment. A lot of people in the military, not everyone, but a lot have come from broken homes, broken backgrounds, and if they don't turn to the military, then it could be a life of crime or life on the streets, just a very bad outcome. So you turn to the military, which will look after you, feed you, it'll train you, it'll instill confidence in you. It's a wonderful way of life. It genuinely is. But it brings people out of their shells and they feel totally at home in that environment. They are looked after. Yes, you might go out and be shot at, you know, it goes with the turf, you know, and all that. But it's the mother and father, which you perhaps didn't have to begin with. And that's what he found. He wasn't happy with his mum and dad, wasn't happy with his grandparents, but he found nurture with that teacher and English and poetry and drama, and then found it with the military. And he became the James Earl Jones that we know and love and respect and now sadly miss. Again, cheers, James. You were magnificent. You are a legend, a true legend. What you did for your culture, your background, your ethnicity, and for people who have, you know, a physical ailment, a mental condition, you are an inspiration, sir. And again, I picked the perfect musical moment to say that, didn't I? Folks, I don't rehearse these things, you know. Well, I think you can tell. But yeah, it's another sad loss. I believe he was working, you know. Well, I'm not sure what the ailment was in the end. But old age, your body just, it's got to go at some point. It doesn't last forever. I know mine will, but that's because I'm fueled with this stuff. But it won't last forever. You can do some maintenance, some fine tuning. You can tinker together some bits and modify yourself, customize yourself. But, you know, at some point the whole thing is just going to go, I can't do any more. But I like to think that in James Earl Jones' case that it was peaceful. I'm sure it was. I haven't heard anything to the contrary of that. And, yeah, Godspeed. Folks, I have been, always shall be, Kilt-Man. Please, in the meantime, and as ever, you know, whatever holds you back, you can beat it in between time. Please keep it Kilty, keep it Celtic, and I'm going to see you all. Later. And I'm going to finish that. Well, I may as well. I've started, so I'll finish. It's wonderful music though, isn't it? Wow, it's gone super hazy. All weathered in one day, everything in one day. Well, we haven't had snow yet, but I wouldn't put it past. Right. Wherever you are, be happy, be healthy, and take the lesson there. I didn't create that lesson. It's James Earl Jones' lesson. You can always fight what holds you back. At the moment, what's holding me back is this misty haze. What's going on? This is crazy. I need like something like a lightsaber to cut through this, to bring light back to the room. Right, we're out of here. Cheers, folks. See you all later.